Next, we're going to examine when input is a sinusoidal signal. Again, the steady-state solution in the S domain is calculated by this equation and examined at S equals to omega I. In our case, if F equals to A sine omega T, the steady-state solution is going to be this. The first term is amplitude and the second term is a phase shift. In time domain, it is going to look like this. A sine function with the amplitude and phase shift. The natural frequency of the system is calculated by equation omega equals to square root of k over m. In our case, it equals to 3.16 rad per second. We know that if an input force has a frequency near the system's natural frequency, the system output signal tends to be big. And when damping of the system is zero, resonance can happen, which means a small vibration disturbance can give you an oscillation of great amplitude. We will first look at the case when input frequency is far from the natural frequency, and then we'll come back to see the resonance. Let's first examine when system is underdamped. Set damping coefficient to be 5 newton second per meter, and we will make the input force to be 10 times sine 30 t. Which means the input force has an amplitude A equals to 10 and its frequency is 30 rads per second. That's about 10 times higher than the natural frequency of the system. Let's run it. So again, it takes a little time to get to the steady state as before. The oscillation still has a shape like previous when there was no input force. But now there is a little small vibration in line with it. It takes a little bit to get to steady state. Okay, after 25 seconds, the system comes to a steady state, but now there is still some small vibration. So let's zoom in to look at the steady state area. Now we zoomed into after 25 seconds where the system comes to a steady state. The amplitude is really small. The peak to valley value is about 0.02, twice of our calculation. This is correct because the one we calculated is the amplitude measured from equilibrium position. Since we can't find the equilibrium position from the figure, we measure the peak to valley value. The frequency at steady state should be equal to frequency of the input, which is 30 rads per second, or a period of 0.2 seconds. And from the peak to peak time period, this is about 0.2 seconds. Now let's change the input frequency to 0.3 rads per second, which is about 10% of the natural frequency. It should take about the same time to get to steady state when there was no input force. So let's wait for a little bit. You see there are some small oscillations at the beginning, which is due to the system response. And our oscillation at the steady state is going to be really slow because the input frequency is only 0.3 rads per second. Therefore, the period is about 20 seconds. So now it's come to a steady state. You can tell from the figure, the period is about 20 seconds. You can calculate the amplitude. This time it gives you 1. And we can see from the peak to valley, it is about 2 from the figure. You might also wonder what the angle we calculate from the formula is. It means the phase shift of the output compared to the input. It is hard to see from the figure, but if you look at the movement of the mass, it is not in sync with the force direction. This difference is described by an angle shift. We worked on the case when system is underdamped. You can try out yourselves to work on the case when system is overdamped. The steady state solution should remain unchanged. In the end, let's try out the resonance case. Let's make the damping ratio to be zero and give the system a small disturbance force. Recall the natural frequency is about 3.16 rads per second, so we'll set the force to be F equals to sine 3.16 times T. We notice that the amplitude is getting bigger and bigger without a tendency to stop. In reality, when input vibration frequency is too close to the natural frequency of the system, the output amplitude will be very big, according to our calculation, even when damping ratio is not zero but relatively small. The collapse of Tacoma Narrow Bridge in 1940 can be explained by this. So in reality, when you design your system, you should consider the range of input frequency and try to avoid the natural frequency of your system to fall into that range.